God, for another day, Lord. We thank you for another year, my God. We thank you, my God, that your provisions have continuously been in our lives, O Lord. My God, you are our provider. You are our healer. You are our God, Lord. And for that, we worship you, my God. And this time here with the saints, O Lord, we lift up our voices. We lift up our hearts. You are worthy of it all, O my God. You are holy, 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 and none can compare to your goodness, O Lord. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity that you give us, O Lord, to lift up our voices in worship, O Lord. And we don't ever want to take that for granted, O Lord. We thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus, we ask you that you bless us today. Help us, my God, to continue to study your word, my God. Help the youth understand, my God, also, my God. Speak to the eager hearts, my God, the hurting hearts are those, my God, that just are willing, my God, to hear your word, my God. I ask you that you bless them, my God. Bless us, bless the congregation upstairs, my God. And we pray, my God, that your word will be edifying as always, my God, in our lives, my God, as we apply it in our lives. So, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen, amen. The youth can go to their class. Sway, how are you, buddy? Good, good. Eric, how are you? Happy New Year to everyone. Happy New Year. The first class of the new year. And we are blessed. We are thankful to the Lord for giving us another year. You know, so now you can watch TV and watch these older movies. And some of these movies are based on the year 2020 and that sort of thing. And you know, we used to watch it in 1996, and they depict that in 2020 there was cars flying in the movie, and it's just so weird to watch those movies to see that none of that has happened yet. And so anyway, I don't know why I went there, but we are in 2022, and the Lord has blessed us with another year. And we always not we as Christians, but I think it's just as perhaps a tradition that has started, I don't know when, but it's always maybe a new year, a new beginning, a new you, something you want to try new, right? The gyms are filled with memberships right now, and maybe early February, mid-February, they're all die down again, be back to norm. Anyway, so we want to be, thank you. We want to be on fire for the Lord the whole year. That's what we want, right? We want to be on fire for the Lord, not just the first couple of weeks of January. And so I definitely, with that sentiment, I definitely invite you to the fasting that we're going to start in January. I believe it starts on Monday, right? So I told my kids, and they could tell you, I told them, I was like, listen, it starts on Monday. Focus on what you want to do. You know, I'm not telling them what to do. I'm kind of reminding them of the things that they could probably fast, right? Because it's not only about food. And I said, if you want to fast sweets, you can. So we have to eat all of them by Sunday. And they looked at me like, it's like, so Sunday we got to eat them all because you can't do it on Monday. But just as I encourage them, I encourage myself as well to do the fast as a congregation. You know what you gotta fast. You know what, if it's food, if it's things, if it's social media, if it's anything that you feel like you want to give your time more to the Lord. And the fasting is not only about getting rid of things, but it's about putting things aside to focus a little bit more on God, right? So if you're fasting social media, if you're fasting sweets, if you're fasting any of these things, and then you want to give that time to the Lord. So you know, ask God to help you with the sweets. If sweets is what drives you, right, emotionally, just ask the Lord to help you with that. And and I told my kids, I was like, if you could do it for the first week, if you could do it for Monday through Thursday, right, great. And then the next week, do it Monday through Saturday. And then the following week, do the whole week, right? So If you need to take steps like that, you know, some of you are more radical, more, you know, gung-ho right at the beginning. God bless you, you know. So more Holy Spirit power to you. But that's to say to join us in the fasting that we will start on Monday. And so it's good for us. It builds us spiritually. It builds us maturity in us as well as Christians. Amen? So join us. All right, so 1 Peter, we'll continue 1 Peter as we have in the last several weeks. 1 Peter, we're in chapter 4, a brief summary from chapter 1, 2, and 3. In chapter 1, the whole gist of Peter's epistle is to encourage the Christians. Really, this is the summary of it. It's to encourage the Christians in regards to their persecution, right? They're being persecuted. Again, in the time of Peter, Nero was the big leader here. He was the Caesar. He was one of the worst murderers ever in history. And Peter is writing this letter in about the time where Nero is in charge. Nero is in charge here. And so Christians are watching other Christians. Christians are watching their brothers and the sisters in Christ being burned alive, being killed, being martyred, being just treated very, very wrong. Just because of their Christian faith. It's not even because they were a certain kind of color. It's not because they were certain, you know, they were cuter than others. No, it was just because they were Christians that were being murdered. And so Peter, in the midst of all of this, understands and realizes that there was a gospel preached to them already, right? When in First Peter talks about how he's writing to the Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, Pontus as well. He's writing to these cities, right, to encourage them from the gospel that they've heard before to keep it, right? The gospel that they've heard before is life. And although they're going through the suffering, to understand that Christ also went through this suffering, the suffering of being humiliated, the suffering of being persecuted, the suffering of dying on the cross. And so Peter kind of encourages the people here to, if Christ went through this for us, all the more we should go through this, right, because of Christ. And so he tells them that in the suffering, have joy, right? And it's such an oxymoron to have to put next to each other, suffering with joy, right? So he's telling them, enjoy this. Enjoy the sufferings because you are in good company. Christ suffered also. And so because Christ suffered for what he did for us, we are in good company suffering for Christ. And so that's the whole gist of 1 Peter, the whole book of Peter. And then and also in there, in the chapters 1 through 3, he encourages, right, the Christians to be submissive to authorities, right? Be submissive to authorities. Because you don't want anybody to point fingers at you. You don't want nobody to say, you know what? Look at that Christian. He doesn't listen to authority. You don't want any of that. And so Peter reminds him, be a Christian. Be Christ-like when it's time to submit to authority. And then from there, right, it goes to wives, be submissive to their husband, right? Everybody, oh, the man loved this. Right? Yeah, it's great, great, yeah. Right? But if you continue reading, right, you have to continue reading, right? You have to be fair. In verse 7 of chapter 7, it says, husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives and treat them with respect as a weaker partner and as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life so that nothing will hinder your prayers. And so what a challenge from Peter, right, to treat our wives with respect, right, with honor, right, to put her in a pedestal, right, in a certain kind of position. Because he says here, your prayers ain't going nowhere if you don't treat your wife correctly, right? And so Peter reminds him as well, a wife submits to your husband, husbands respect your wives as well. And so in all of this, we start with chapter 4, which is living for God. And it depending on the translation that you have, it breaks the verses in every so section here, but we're going to go verses 1 through 19 in chapter 4. And it reads like this: therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because he has suffered in his body. He who has suffered in his body is done with sin. As a result, he does not live the rest of his earthly life for the evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. For he has spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. They think it strange that you do not plunge with them into the same flood of dispensation, and they heap abuse on you. But they'll have you give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is the reason the gospel was preached, even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged according to men in regard to the body, but live according to God in regard to the spirit. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled, so that you can pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each one should be whatever gift he has received to serve others. Each one should use, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Verse 12. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ. He reminds them here again. So that you may be overjoyed, there we go again, when his glory is revealed. If you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed. For the spirit of glory and of God rest on you. If you suffer, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal, or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with the family of God. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? Verse 18, and if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? So then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. Amen? Amen. So here, verses 1 through 6, we know since Christ has gained victory, right? Peter here kind of urges his readers to redirect themselves to God, right? He wanted to kind of strengthen again, to continue to persevere in their suffering, right? And so generally speaking, as we can break this down, verses 1 and 3 talks about the Christian behavior. How should we respond, right? And verses 4 through 6 is kind of the pagan response to all of this. And so when we look at verse 1, therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. So Peter's present appeal here grew out of what Jesus said about what Peter says about Christ's victory. So in view of this example, of committing himself to accomplishing God's will, and so what Peter wants is for us to be in victory in God's will, just as Christ was. And so Jesus, it says here the word suffered, right? Suffered is good word here to describe what Christ went through, to the point where he actually was dying on the cross, right? He died on the cross. And so Christians, to this extent, also should also expect to suffer, right? If our master, the one that we serve, suffered, how much more us should we suffer, right? If he was mocked, if he was chastised, if he was spat on, if he was talked about, right? How much more in the world that we live in today? And so the last part of this verse, Peter probably means that his readers had identified themselves with Christ's suffering and death. And so if we look at the last part of the verse 1, it says, because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. And so what he also wants is, as we suffer with Christ or for Christ, for us to die to the sin, meaning to die to this world, right? Don't, as you suffer, don't suffer as a Christian and then disobey the government, per se. Don't suffer as a Christian, say you're suffering as a Christian, and then go and be a mockery to somebody else, because now you're living two different lives, right? What he's saying is, suffer as Christ suffered and be Christian. Don't complain, right? And so Peter wants to remind them of their attitude. Be of good attitude when you suffer. And so they should therefore put sin behind them, right, and live this cleanful life that they've chosen. And so what Peter's trying to do for them is, it's always a reminder with Peter here. He reminds the people, remember how you used to live in this sinful life, right? No longer you live like that. Now you live for Christ. And the way that you live without this sinful life that you were living before. And he says, because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. And so just as Christ is done with sin, as he suffered in his body, so are you. You no longer live in this sinful life. Now that you suffer for Christ, you are done with that. You're no longer bound to that. Amen? And so the cool thing about, as we study Peter, is how he tries to remind the people, live as Christ lived. Act as Christ act. Respond to things the way Christ responded. Take it. Take the suffering. Because Jesus took it for us. And so Peter is constantly reminding them the example of Christ. And I think that's pretty awesome when you study and when you read Peter, how he's trying to encourage them. Not just with words, but he says, people, listen to me. He says, listen to me. Christ went through this. And if he who we serve went through this, we're going to go through this. And so he says, so live joyfully. Go through it joyfully eventually, right? So Peter apparently probably meant that suffering with Christ should lead to a more holy life, right? So this is why Peter encourages them, you've left the sinful life. Now you're living for Christ. And as you live for Christ, now you live this holy life. Right? So for example, this just came to mind. I'm not even sure if this is a good example. But, right, we had this carnal life that we lived in, right? For those who weren't born in church, right? We've had this carnal life. And then now, let's say you're a Christian and you're a believer and then you're a sanctified, holify, and, you know, baptized, speaking in tongues, Holy Spirit filled, you know, whatever kind of guy and gal, right? And then somebody just irks you, right? And then barks at you and irks you and just wants to, and then your old self might come out, right? Or your Christian self might contain yourself. And that's what Peter says. You no longer live that life. The life that you live, although you're suffering, live it as a holy life because you're living it for Christ. So it wants to come out because that's the old life. But that life, you leave it behind. You've left it behind. Now this is a new life. And this life that you live should be a life lived in holiness. And so Peter reminds them of that. In verse 2, look at verse 2. It says, as a result, he does not live the rest of his earthly life for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. So Peter wants to clarify here the commitment to God's will in this verse. So Peter was probably urging his readers here not to live according to the lust of men, during the remaining time in the flesh, right? So depending on the script, on the translation you have, I think this is the, oh, this is the New International Version. So here it says, as a result, he does not live in the rest of his earthly life, meaning in his flesh, right? The lust, so he urges here the readers not to live in the lust of the flesh, right? Not to live in that kind of time that, that you were living before. And so we might not always understand that God, what God is doing, right? But we know that God is doing something for us, what's best for us. And so what he says is don't live in this flesh, right? Verse 3, Peter's, verse 3 here says, for you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. And so Peter here reminds the readers here that they spent probably some time doing all of these things. And so it's perhaps a warning to Gentiles' practices that they had in those days. And so he reminds them, you've spent time doing all of this already. Don't do this anymore. And so and as we know, the people that Peter was writing to here were not Jews. They were Gentiles. And Gentiles, obviously, were not not from the promise, but Gentiles now became Christians. And so Peter is reminding them, remember, you live like this no longer, right? It says, for you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do. Don't do that anymore. We're beyond that now because we have this life. And so he moves on to verse 4 where it says, they think it's strange. And this is pretty interesting too. It says, they think it is strange that you do not plunge with them into the same flood of dissipation, and they heap abuse on you. And so this is exactly what happens today to us. It is exactly what was happening in Peter's time. What they were doing is people that weren't Christians were looking at the Christians and saying, what? This is strange. Why would you not want to drink and have a good time? Why would you not want to have orgies, right? And whatever carousing is and detestable idolatry. Why would you not want to do that? And so they didn't understand that now these Christians, these Gentiles that were doing those things before, are no longer living that life. And it's exactly what happens today. It's exactly what happens in families when someone gets saved and then the family's like, You don't want to go here? You don't want to do that anymore? You don't want to do this? And that's exactly what was happening with Peter. So this continues to be today, this common, I don't want to call it persecution, but a common signaling of Christians out in this way. That now all of a sudden you have this holy life that you can't come and hang out with us anymore. And I think everything is with moderation, right? There's certain places that you should not be, right, as Christians. There's certain people that you probably should not hang out with if they entice you, right? I think I leave that all to your discretion. But if I, anyway, I leave that to all to your discretion. And so what Peter is trying to tell them that you're going to get this. You're going to get those that are Gentile non-Christians to try to entice you to all these worldly things that you used to do before you were Christian. And so he reminds them again to be careful with that. And so verse 5, but we go to verse 5, says, but they will have to give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. And so Peter reminds his readers that God would condemn their unsafe friends' behavior. And so regardless of where they are or of what their friends are doing, they're going to have to give an account to God, right? And so the judge was already ready to judge the physical living and the physical dead. And so this dead here, the living and the dead, is not the same dead that we looked at in chapter 3, in the last part of chapter 3. Okay, so those are totally different. Different dead people. And so Peter tells them they're going to be held accountable as well. And so 4 and 5 is just a reminder to them not to be enticed with those that are Gentiles, non-Christians. Not to be enticed, because why do you want to do that again? Okay? It's easier to do it than not do it. Peter says, why do that? Why go back to that? Remember, you're living a life, it's a suffering life, and it should be a holy life. Amen? So Peter viewed that those who slander Christians for their lifestyles as really slandering God. And so who called us out of darkness into light. And so as non-Christians call out Christians, what they're really doing is calling out God. As they're mocking Christians, they're mocking God. Because we don't follow certain type of rules made by man. We follow what God has led us to follow, right? So when people are mocking us, they're really mocking God. And so that's what Peter's trying to tell them. He tells them there in verse 5, but they will give account to him who's ready to judge the living and the dead. Verse 6, for this is the reason the gospel was preached even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged according to men in regard to the body, but living according to God in regard to the spirit. And so, because everyone will give an account to his life to God, Christians preach the gospel, right? We're all going to give account to God, Christians, non-Christians. And Paul says the gospel was preached to them, right? It was preached to them, and they are going to get an account before God. So they make it possible, right? The gospel makes it possible for them to somehow either reject it or accept it. And beyond that, they are going to give an account to God. And so in Peter's day, Christians had preached the gospel to other people who had become Christians and now they died. And so this is what Peter is saying, right? Peter is saying, even those who are now dead, right? For this is the reason the gospel was preached even to those who are now dead. The gospel was preached to certain people. They are now dead, right? They'll experience a judgment as well, just like any other, right? But that's what Peter is trying to tell them there, that even those that are dead have heard the gospel. And so even the living that are mocking you or mocking us, they have heard the gospel as well. And so even though these brethren had experienced judgment for their sins by dying physically, they lived on in a new spiritual sphere of life since they were believers. And so these are the Christian believers, right? They've heard the gospel, they accepted the gospel, they accepted Christ, and now they're dead. And so these are other type of believers that now no longer live with us. So some people have taken this verse to say that that this is perhaps a second opportunity that people get when they're dead, that they incorporate the last part of chapter 3, where we talked about a couple weeks ago, where people interpret as Jesus going to Hades, to hell, and preaching to the demons there. They incorporate that part of chapter 3 with this verse here to say that Christ, that there's a second opportunity for the dead to accept the gospel. That's not true. This is the only life we have. And so don't think that you could do whatever you want and then you die and you go to whatever they call it, purgatory, right? Although the Roman Catholic doesn't believe that anymore. But it was a big belief where there was a purgatory, a place where it was between hell and heaven, and you were just there for a little while until everything finished and then they'll get back to you, kind of thing. And so the belief was that you were there and then they would preach the gospel to you. And that's not true, right? This is the life that we have. This is a one-shot kind of thing, and that's it. And so we can't take the end of chapter 3 with this verse here. When we look at verse 7, the end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. And so Peter, Paul, James, all these apostles believed in that Christ was coming back again, that his second coming was near. They all believed that they were going to see it. All of them believed that. And so what Peter was trying to do here is kind of prepare the readers to suffer a little longer. He'll be right back. He'll be here soon. Just suffer a little more. And 2,000 years later, we're still here, right? But their belief was that he was coming soon. He was coming in their time. And since those generations, that belief has always been, you know, he's coming soon, he's coming soon, he's coming soon. Soon is relative, right? Soon for you could mean, you know, a week for you, 2 months for me. Soon is it's very relative, very, very, there's no time in soon. And so Peter's belief was this. Peter's belief was that, encouraging the body, the Christians, that the end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. So he tells them, don't despair. Don't lose control. Be controlled, self-control, because that's what's going to help you be in communion with God in your prayer. Okay? So, so they were to remain clear-headed, right, of sound judgment, which means clear mind, have a sound judgment on things, self-controlled. Other versions have it as sober spirit, right? So they could primarily pray properly, so that they can pray properly. And so this statement, the end of all things is at hand. Be serious and watchful in your prayers. Really illustrates the importance of prayer, right? Be self-controlled, be subdued, be clear-minded, so that you can actually pray, so that your prayer can be practical and tactical, right? And so that goes in all things. But Peter reminds him again here, I know what you're going through. Be self-controlled, be of sober spirit, so that when you pray, it kind of reaches God, kind of thing, right? So prayer is the most noble and necessary ministry that God entrusts to his children. But it's also the most neglected ministry. And it really is. I work with a good friend of mine. He was not Episcopalian. He was one of these more liberal denominations. He was a really nice guy, really nice. And I remember talking to him and expressing the disappointment at times of coming to prayer and not seeing a lot of people. And he said to me, he has his doctor in ministry now. He's one of those big guys that you just want to hug and just stay there and hug. Like, he's such a teddy bear. He's like such a nice guy, right? Such a good spirit guy. And he told me, he said, you know, only about 7% or no, it's only about 3-7% of your congregation will go to prayer. And so, and that's the statistics that shown in church of how people view the importance of prayer. That it's not something that is at the top list for anybody or for everybody. And it's neglected. It's a ministry that's left aside. It's a ministry that really not a lot of churches think about. And it's really, it's sad, obviously, right? But if there's anything that Jesus did, it was pray, right? In Gethsemane, he prayed. And I think this is where Peter gets this from. Peter saw Jesus prayed in Gethsemane. He understood the importance of prayer before the suffering of Christ, right? I mean, he had suffered, but this was going to really be it. And so it's that, I think that probably was a culmination for him to realize how much, how important prayer was for one's life. And so this is a nice quote here. It says, proper prayer is not an escape, but rather a function of clear vision and a seeking of even clearer vision from God. And so prayer is us talking to God, right? Letting their spirit just flow in us and asking God to help us with whatever it is. Or not even so much helping us, but giving God glory in everything that we say, right? In everything that we do. And so it is an important ministry, an important part in our lives. And that's what, you know, we always encourage to come to prayer and seek prayer and, you know, for any kind of thing, any small thing that you think is insignificant, if you find it significant, I believe God finds it significant as well. And so we should always be ready to pray. Amen? Verse 8. It says, above all, right? Again, Paul's about, he's like a good outlook calendar, right? He just reminds you. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers above a multitude of sins. And so in relation to all of this, right? Be of sober spirit, be of a clear mind, behave, right? Listen. All of those things, right? Tells them to behave in all these Christian ways. But above all, love each other, right? Because this covers a multitude of sins. So Peter considered it the most important that his readers to keep their brotherly love at full strength, right? The person with this kind of love is willing to what? To forgive and even what? Covers a multitude of sins that others committed against him. Himself or herself, rather than taking offense. And so we cannot compensate for our sins by loving others. Peter was not saying that, right? We can't compensate, meaning we can't pay off or we can't make up for our sins, right? By loving others. The proper way to deal with our sins is what? To confess, right? To confess. And so love hides them from its own sight. This is a quote. Love hides him from its own sight and not from God's sight. Right? So in Peter's day, Christians had preached. I read this part already. Right? So what Peter is trying to tell them here is don't hold anybody accountable for anything. Right? Love covers everything. Love says covers over a multitude of sins. And so that's not to say that somebody or you do something to someone or someone does something to you and you say, well, you know, we love each other. So it's nothing like that. It has nothing to do with that. But it is to Paul, Peter reminds them that there's no sense of holding grudges. There's no sense of holding off or saying, you know, don't talk to me now, because that won't do anything. And so above all, love each other, right? And again, it's at your discretion how you deal with that relationship, with that issue. But above all, love each other, right? And so Peter reminds him here, because he understands that there is this kind of intensity in their surroundings and how they're living. And so it's a reminder for them. So when things do happen, not to point fingers at no one, right? As Christians. Because what happens then? Well, Peter reminds them, Peter tells them, right? I think it's in chapter 2, is that people will begin to point at you. People begin to look at you. People begin to see, oh, look at that Christian. You know, he holds grudges, or he says this, or he says that. And, you know, oh, it was a little thing here and there. Peter says, no, have nothing to do with that. Love each other. Verse 9, it says, offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. The same issue here, right? Be hospitable. So there's no reason to be bickering at each other when we have bigger issues here. Nero's trying to kill us. Verse 10, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others faithfully, administering God's grace in its various forms. This is, I'll read verse 11 as well. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength of God. With the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. So verses 10 and 11 here is just a reminder for us that we all have a gift. There's a gift in each and every one of us. And that gift that God has given us, it really is, at the end of the day, to glorify God, for God. And so whatever gift it is, if it's the gift to serve, if it's a gift to do the projector, if it's a gift to, evangelize, a gift to preach, a gift to teach, a gift to any kind of gift that you have, do it for the glory of God. And so Peter tells him, you have a gift. God has deposited in you a gift. Now he says, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others. The gift that you have is not for self indulgence, right? It's for you to serve others. If you have the gift of tongue, it's not so you can blah, 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 blah all year round. It's, Paul even says that a bigger gift is that one who translates, right? A gift that you have is not so people can look at you and say, wow, Eric, that guy, man, he is a preacher. And Eric said, yeah, it's a gift. No. The gift that God has given us and deposited in us is so that we can serve others. You preach and you teach and you serve and you're a deacon, and all that is to serve the church. You're serving others. And in serving others, you're giving God the glory in all of it. In music ministry, if you sing, most of you have not heard me sing. You don't want to, because that's not a gift I have. But those who do sing, that's a gift. Is it a gift to glorify? No, it's not a gift to give themselves any kind of glory. But it's a gift to sing unto the Lord and to the for the congregation to come into the presence as well, right? It's a gift that God has given us. If you know how to play the piano, if you know how to play the drums, if you know how to play the triangle, right? That's a gift, right? I'm sure the triangle is hard. I don't know. But it's a gift. And Peter says, serve others with that gift. Live for God. And serving others. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. And it says, to him be the glory. So in all that you do, in all that you serve, and everything that you want to do, and all the gifts that God has deposited in you, you give him the glory. You do it to serve others. You don't do it to bring yourself any kind of glory. Because the day that you do, I mean, I don't want to be there, but the day that you do, I don't want to see what happens to someone like that. Because you don't, that's not the God, it's not a gift. If you have a gift, that gift is not for you, just for you. And so one of the things I ministered a long time ago was that when you do have a gift and you don't exercise that gift that God has given you, and you know that you're gifted in a certain thing, and you don't exercise that gift because you just don't want to, not because you don't know, right? But because you know you have it and you don't want to, then what you're doing is you're taking from the people a blessing, right? So if you're good at teaching or you're good at preaching and you don't want to do any of that because perhaps you're shy or, right, could be different things. What you're doing is actually you're taking a blessing from the people because God has given you that, a gift, right, of preaching or teaching or even serving, right, whatever gift it is. You take from people. And so you're stealing from them. You're taking from them a blessing. And that's not where you want to be. We don't want to be there. We don't want to be in a position where we're taking anything from anyone. You know, if God has given you a gift and you're timid about it, shy about it, you're a certain kind of more the personality, right? Ask God to help you because he did it with Moses, right? Moses, he couldn't speak. So he sent Aaron, right? So there you go. And so there was a gift there from Moses, but God, you know, he had to flourish in that. Moses had to flourish in that. And so, same way, God will do something. If you ask God to help you with whatever gift that God has given you, believe me, if it's for his glory, if it's for his honor, he will help you. Amen? Amen. So don't be taking nothing from no one. No blessing. When we look at verse 12, and so these are more suffering for being a Christian. My dear friends, it says, do not be surprised at the painful trial you're suffering as though something strange were happening to you. Again, he tells him, this is not anything new. Don't be surprised. Because I've already told you, as Christ suffered, you will also suffer as well. And so this is nothing strange. This is nothing new to you. This is the life that you live and suffer it. Joyfully, really. Okay. Oh, verse 13. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when they beat you. Oh no, when his glory is revealed. Right? When his glory is over, when his glory is revealed, when you are going through this suffering, and his glory is revealed. What a joy, what a overjoy it would be as that you're suffering, God is getting all the glory, right? I mean, a great example for that for us is, I mean, a fact from Jesus, Stephen, right? Our first martyr, beaten down with stones. And in the midst of the suffering, in the midst of the pain, right, he sees the glimpse, right? And it's God, that's Christ. And through all that pain, I mean, I don't know what horrific pain that is to be, you know, be put to death through stones and those stones hitting you. And then you get a glimpse in that suffering, in that pain, in that you're about to die, you get a glimpse of God. He says here, but rejoice that you participate in the sufferings. It's a reminder for us as well, right? A reminder for the Christians who live in Africa and in nations that just for taking out a Bible, they kill you and they slaughter you. Just a couple of weeks ago, I think I heard in the news, there was about... 12 Christians, I don't know if it was in Africa or South Africa, I think it might have been Africa, that they were able to escape from the hands of the people that were holding them hostage. And they walked about 10 miles, this was in the news, and they walked about 10 miles and they were able to evacuate where they were safe. I can't imagine being in a camp like that and knowing that I could die anytime, any day. And so that kind of persecution, that kind of thinking, right, that Peter reminds him, even in the suffering, you know, rejoice, be glad, because in all reality, guys, we are in good company. That's why he tells them, we are in good company. Right? He says, rejoice that you participate. Now, participate, the word participate, is almost like you're volunteering, right? Like you're participating in something. Like if you don't want to participate, you don't participate, right? Right? Like nobody's forcing you. Of course, like, you know. But we are Christians, and we are participating in this suffering with Christ. It says, if you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed, for the Spirit of glory and God rest on you. So we are insulted. Every time somebody mocks us, anytime somebody looks at us in anger, anytime anybody talks bad about us, it says, Peter says, if you are insulted because of the name of Christ, you are blessed. So blessings come to us, right? Blessings are for us. When people mock us, when people talk about us, when people ridicule us, people want to just put us down. What they're actually doing is putting down God. They're trying to put down God. But God tells us that you are blessed, right? We are blessed because of it. If you suffer it, verse 15, it should not be as a murderer or thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. However, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. So Peter says, if you suffer, don't suffer because you're a thief. They're going to kill you. They're going to slaughter you. Don't suffer for those silly things. Suffer because you're a Christian. It says, if you suffer as a Christian, do not be ashamed, but praise God that you bear that name. Praise God that you bear the name of being a Christian, because it comes from Christ. Right? So don't, if you're going to suffer, don't suffer because you're being a thief, you're stealing something, and then you get caught, and now you got to die, right? Or whatever they say. Or don't suffer because you're a murderer, and now you're going to be put to death. Don't suffer for that. There's no joy in that. You got caught, and that's it. But if you're going to suffer, suffer because of the name that you have, the name that you're called, a Christian. Suffer for that. That's rejoice. Like that, you can rejoice in suffering for that. And so I love how Peter continuously, if you read, continue to read, he continuously reminds them that the suffering that they're going through is worth the suffering. The joy that should be in the suffering that they have should be maximal. It should be at a high point. And he's encouraging them. This is, listen, when the people in this time read this, I'm sure they didn't read it like, oh yes, you know, we're gonna rejoice in the sufferings and the end is near, and so be clear in mind. No, I'm sure they read this and they were like, oh my God, you know, this is what we're going through. This is what's happening. This is what an encouragement. What a way to lift our spirits up, right? I'm assuming that's how they probably read it. I don't know. But when you read something like this and you think back of the kind of person that Peter was, right? Peter was a hard-headed kind of guy, right? Even Paul gets on him later on because of who he was trying to portray in front of the Gentiles and the Jews. And so Paul and him have a little scuffle, and Paul really corrects him and rebukes him. And so even in that, Peter, I believe it was before he wrote this, but even in that, Peter tries to remind them not to live in the way they used to live, but be reminded that you are a Christian now. And so, we're going to suffer being a Christian. And Peter writes this as he's also being persecuted. with Paul and I don't know if it was James or John, I believe. But he writes this in the midst of him suffering as well. So he doesn't just write this to just write it. He writes it as a man who denied Christ three times, right? And was being signaled out and being wanting to, people wanting to kill him as well. And so he writes knowing what it is to live on the outside, you know, meaning outside of being persecuted and looked upon and, you know, oh, you're a Christian? So he knows what it is to deny Christ, right? And he's trying to encourage them, don't do that. If you're going to die, die for Christ, right? Verse 17, for it is the time for judgment to begin with the family of God, and it begins with us. What will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? So he tells them, if us Christians, right, we're going to be at judgment as well, how much more those that are not Christian, right, and did not obey the gospel, they too will be judged. And so he again tries to remind them that we're all going to be judged here. And so our suffering is now, right? But theirs will be, those that are not Christians, will be when they stand before God in judgment. So our judgment, our sufferings are part of the opening scene in the last, this is a quote here, in the last act of God's redemptive drama. More severe judgment will follow on the ungodly. And I believe that that's true, because there's more to judge on those who are unbelievers, those who have denied Christ, than those who have accepted Christ. We'll be judged for the things that we do and the things that we've said and the things that we haven't done and the things we haven't said. Right? God will judge us according, but we are saved. Right? We are saved. And so there's more detrimental for those that are unsaved. Those will be judged more harshly. Right? And so Peter reminds them of that here. Verse 18, and if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Verse 19, so then, those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to their faithful Creator and continue to do good. And so, so it will be more difficult, verse 18, right, for the godless people to pass from this phase of their lives to the next, because they will have to undergo God's wrath. It's the same concept as verse 17. So he quotes here verses chapter 11, verse 31 from Proverbs. And it was kind of to show that the Old Testament was also tough both to the righteous and the wicked. And both will receive from the Lord. And so both will be judged by the Lord. And so the point of the proverb here is that God rewards the righteous here on earth. How much more can we count on his rewarding wicked sinners? And so God gives us the righteousness that we have in Christ here on earth, right? And we'll be judged when we die. But it's more harsh for those that are unbelievers here on earth and also after as well. And so it's kind of like a double whammy for them, right? Like you got a bad here and you got to have a bad over there. So our sufferings are light compared to those that are ungodly, those that will experience in the, what they will experience in the future. And so verse 19, I think we read it. So then those who suffer according to God's will should commit themselves to the faithful Creator and continue to do good. And so he encourages them again here to those who suffer according to God's will, right? Those who, you Christians who are suffering, commit yourselves to the faithful Creator and continue to work, continue to do good, continue to live out this Christian walk in holiness. And so this is chapter 4, right? The first 11 verses talks about, you know, living your life before God, for God, and living and having at the end, right? He says, talks about those gifts that you have. They are for God as well. And so verses 12 to 19 is a reminder that we are still suffering as Christians. And even as you're suffering, this judgment that comes will be lighter on us than on the unbelievers. And so there'll be judgment as well, but we are justified through Christ. Amen? And so I really enjoy reading Peter because it's such a reminder, even for us today, of how much we are in need of being reminded of the things that go on in this world that sometimes despair us, right? The sufferings that go on, the things that go on. And Paul says that even as you suffer, and he specifically talks about suffering in regards to persecution. Perhaps we don't go through the persecution that Peter talks about here in the United States, depending how you define persecution, right? I don't think it comes down to this kind of persecution, but the persecution that goes around the world to Christians that are preaching and teaching the gospel, people in Africa or, you know, in the Middle East, and it's just unprecedented to even fathom the kind of things that they go through their mind, you know. When you talk about missionaries, you know, I'd be a missionary in Hawaii and San Diego, right? These missionaries are in the most horrific places in the world and just want to preach the gospel. And so when they read through Peter, hopefully it's a reminder to them that if they went through it, right, in the most horrific time with Nero, you know, I can go through it too, and I could go through this suffering rejoicing, right? And so it's a reminder for us too, and whatever it is that you consider persecution in our lives, and then in the United States, you know, I mean, maybe persecution against different kind of agendas that they're out there. Let us go through it rejoicing and joyfully. Amen? Amen. So next week, I believe, is chapter 5. I think that's the last one there. Chapter 5. But it's a good reminder for us. Amen? Amen. Amen. All right. Let's pray. Any questions, comments? No? All right. Father, we thank you, my God. We thank you for your word, Lord. We thank you, my God, for keeping us, oh Lord. We ask you, Father, that you help us, oh Lord. That you remind us, my God, that in times of trials, Lord, in times of trouble, Lord, that you are there with us, oh Lord. That we live for you, my God. That we will always uphold, my God, our testimony, my God, before man, Lord. That they would never be able to signal us out, my God. That they would never be able to point fingers at us, oh Lord. Help us, my God, to maintain, my God, who we are, my God, in you, my God. For it's your name, my God, for your sake, oh Lord. For you, my God, we live, my God, and we want to be able to live our lives as Christians, my God, as men and women, my God, that serve you, my God. My God, help us, my God, to evaluate, my God, the gifts that you have poured in us, my God. Help us, my God, with our character, who we are, my God, and that gift that you have deposited in us, oh Lord, so that we'll be able to serve, my God, your church, my God, your people, my God, so that we can give you glory, so that you can get all the honor, my God, that you can get all the praise, oh Lord. My God, we do it for you, my God. My God, in the name of Jesus, oh Lord, I thank you for this night. I thank you for my brothers. I ask you, my God, that you use them, my God, mighty and powerfully, my God, in all the areas in the ministry, my God, that you have for them, oh Lord. Bless.